Good evening and welcome to the May 2nd meeting of the Lisle Planning and Zoning Commission. This is a continuation of the April 18th public hearing on the UTI of Illinois 2611 Corporate Drive West special use permit for planned unit development and other requests for development of two-story 185,000 square foot building for the Universal Technical Institute for use as its Midwest region campus. At this point, Josh, would you please call the meeting to order by taking the roll?
Member Farrar?
Here.
Member Gavin?
Here.
Member Goetz is absent. Member Hedich?
Here.
Member Murphy?
Here.
Member Thorne?
Here.
Chairman Rigo?
Here. At our last meeting, we got through part of the petitioner's presentation, so with no further ado, I'd ask the petitioner to come forward and continue their presentation.
Good evening.
Just remind everybody that speaks tonight that if you were sworn in at the last meeting, you're still under oath, but please state your name for the record, and we'll make sure that we've got you under oath. Thank you.
Good evening, Russ Whitaker. We will get right into our presentations. I think we have five or six this evening. First presenter we have this evening is John Brown, civil engineer with the V3 Companies.
Good evening, Mr. Brown. If you could state your name and your affiliation for the record, please.
Absolutely.
Sworn in.
John Brown with V3 Companies, 7325 James Avenue, Woodridge, Illinois.
Do you solemnly swear that everything you say will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Good evening again. John Brown with V3. Just a couple quick things in terms of qualifications. This hasn't run, started the slideshow yet, actually. What is it?
F5.
All right, I know it's here. Slideshow, there it is.
There we go. Sorry about that. I am here to present our preliminary stormwater management plan and talk a little bit about some of the biological environment elements. Just a couple quick things in terms of my qualifications. I have 21 years of site engineering experience. I'm a licensed professional engineer in Illinois. A member of NAOP, which is a commercial real estate development organization, and a Bachelor of Science in Engineering from the University of Illinois. Again, I'm with V3 Companies. Our firm was founded 29 years ago. We are a registered professional design firm in Illinois, and a major focus of our work is on site development and infrastructure design with an emphasis on commercial development. Just like to start off a little bit with, in terms of our stormwater management analysis, the scope of our study, which involved the analysis of the existing stormwater management system on the site today, an analysis of the impact of the proposed redevelopment, design of a stormwater management system that ultimately meets the requirements of the village and the county ordinances, and in terms of our redevelopment, what we'll be creating is a little under 4 acres of additional impervious area from what's out there on the site today, and that's what we have to manage. Just in terms of methodology, our analysis, again, we looked at existing drainage conditions and the existing stormwater that's on the site today, determining how much more detention we're going to need based on the added impervious area, and then developing a drainage plan based on all of that. This first slide I'd like to talk about is the existing conditions drainage plan. The overall site is approximately 20 acres, and what we're looking at is the what I'm calling the project area is about 17 acres, and that's everything south of Corporate West Drive, because Corporate West and everything to the north is not going to be modified. So there's a main existing drainage divide that's depicted by that heavy line running north-south roughly through the middle of the site, and that splits the site into an east drainage basin and a west drainage basin. The east basin is about 6.5 acres, and that drains to the northeast and ultimately discharges under Warrenville Road and then continues on to the northeast through the Corporate Lakes Business Park. The runoff in that area is currently detained in some existing detention areas. There's a dry detention basin along the tollway, a very narrow little area down at the bottom of the plan there. And then there's some existing parking lot storage with on the pavement in the existing east parking lot. So that's what's happening in current conditions on the east. The west is about 10.5 acres, and that drains to the west and ultimately through a discharges through a storm sewer pipe and continues on to the ponds south of Hilton, and ultimately that discharges under the tollway and continues to the south. And there's an existing dry detention basin depicted there on that west side of the site. Holds about 2.3 acre-feet of detention volume. So this is the existing drainage conditions, the existing drainage pattern, and we will be maintaining that in with the proposed redevelopment. This next exhibit is the proposed conditions drainage plan, and as mentioned, we're gonna basically match what's happening out there today. Runoff from the redevelopment from the site is going to be captured internally and collected and detained in the proposed stormwater management system. So what we have, based on the requirements of the new county ordinance that's been adopted, we'll be handling the stormwater from this site and especially any added impervious areas that have been created and detaining that on site. For the east basin, there was about 0.1 acre feet or 0.8 acre feet of existing detention on that east area. We'll be maintaining that, and then based on our added impervious area, we're going to need to add approximately another 0.3 acre feet for a total volume of a little over 1.1 acre feet. And what's proposed right now is to detain that in an underground detention vault under the east parking lot. The west drainage basin will be adding about, there's about 2.3 acre feet of detention there today. We're adding about 3 acres of impervious area. We have to manage and detain that additional runoff from that additional impervious area. And the net result is adding about 0.8 of an acre foot of additional detention, which we will do by expanding that existing detention basin. And what we've done is actually localized or focused the expansion area in the area there about the middle of the west property line is where we'll expand that existing pond. It's actually an area where one of the existing wings of the buildings juts out into that area, so it was an ideal area with very few trees in that particular spot. So we're trying to minimize the impacts in that particular location. We are going to be able to essentially save the majority of the trees in the southwest corner of that site based on some of the approach that we're taking with that expanded detention. There's a couple other things that we need to address with the to meet the stormwater ordinance, and that's water quality and volume control of the runoff, and we'll be accommodating that in either a mechanical water quality structures to filter the water or water quality basins depending on where we're at in the site. And then the ponds themselves or the detention basins themselves will also have an infiltration aspect to them to promote infiltration into the subsoils. So in summary, in terms of detention, we're going to be maintaining the little over 3 acre feet of detention that's out there today. We're adding about 3.9 acres of new impervious area, providing a little over 1 acre foot of additional volume on top of what's out there today, and we'll be providing water quality and volume control measures to meet the requirements of the ordinance. Next thing I'd just like to briefly talk about is biological environment. In terms of endangered species, we have completed a consultation with the Illinois Department of Natural Resources. The IDNR has reviewed our information and concluded that adverse effects to threatened and endangered species are unlikely. So that consultation is done and terminated. And the last item I'd like to touch on is wetlands. We have completed a wetland delineation for the property that was field verified by DuPage County staff. There is one very small wetland in the far northwest corner of the site depicted here. It's about 0.003 of an acre. It's an area where we're not going to be doing any work. There'll be no impact to it or to the buffer around it. So we have no wetland impacts for this project. That concludes my portion of the presentation, and turn it back over to Russ Whitaker. Thank you.
Next, I'm going to ask Leslie Condon to come up. Leslie's with ECS Midwest and performed the environmental components, emissions, noise, and fluid storage for the site.
Leslie Condon with ECS Midwest, 1575 Barclay Boulevard, Buffalo Grove, Illinois. Okay, a little bit background on ECS. We are a geotechnical engineering, construction materials testing, and environmental services firm. We were founded in 1988 and have over 990 employees throughout 30 offices located within 10 different states. Bit of background on me. I have a bachelor's of science in geology from the University of Illinois with 8 years of experience in the environmental science field. Various project management, field inspections, and submitting proposals in reports for various environmental fields, including environmental assessments, underground storage tank removals, closures, surveys for asbestos, water damage, lead-based paint, and then indoor air quality assessments and lead air sampling. Various licenses for asbestos and lead inspections as well. Seeing this project as well was my environmental services manager, Dave Kwasaborski, who has over 15 years of experience in the environmental sciences field. He's a Bachelor of Science in Environmental Geology from the University of North Dakota and Master of Sciences pending from the University of Montana. He also has experience in many of the areas that I have, including oversight and of the staffing and quality control of our reports. And he also has experience doing recommendations and design for engineering and institutional controls regarding cleanup and remedial actions. The first portion of the project that we were involved with was the noise evaluation. We initially wanted to determine what we would consider a worst case sound level, sound levels that are currently being generated at the UTI facility in Glendale Heights. Throughout active use of their training laboratories and associated ventilation systems. We wanted to then compare these levels that we detected to the applicable Village of Lisle Chapter 15 of the Village Zoning Ordinance. Do you know why I'm doing that? And then based on these, we would provide recommendations as necessary. In order to accomplish this, we utilized a sound level meter. That's a particular meter that we used, and we used the measurements that it includes is from 0 to 140 decibels, which is pretty much the range of human audible sound. We collected measurements from the Glendale Heights facility, including throughout the property and along the boundaries with the residential properties nearby. We collected baseline or ambient measurements, and then we collected the worst case measurements while equipment was running at the facility.
Keep going.
Okay. I need to go back one screen. Okay, so we also collected baseline and ambient measurements from the proposed Lisle location. The worst case measurements collected at the Glendale Heights facility were collected during the course of two separate laboratory sessions, one focused on the diesel engine area, the other focused on the gasoline engine area. This was during typical laboratory activities while the training engines were running. And then we conducted additional sampling while the dynos were running for the performance engine and the chassis dyno. Here's a table of the worst case readings that we collected throughout the course of the day and throughout the different laboratory run times. You will see kind of halfway down the page, immediately south of the performance dyno door, we did get a reading which would be considered above the residential daytime village ordinance of 65. The reading was just slightly above. But then you can see the what I sampled along the fence line at the west edge of the parking lot during the running of the performance dyno. We were well below the range of what would be considered within the residential limits. And this is also significantly below what the commercial limits would be. While one of the other dynos was running, the immediately south bay door of the chassis dyno, we also got readings up to 68, which is, once again, slightly above the residential daytime level, but well below the commercial daytime level. And once we stepped away further, approximately 30 feet from or along the boundary with the school next door, we were well below what would be considered what is the residential daytime limit. We collected the background ambient measurements while no equipment was running throughout various areas around the properties, and especially with the boundaries with the residential areas. And as you can see, there were measurements varying from about 47 and a half through about 56 to 60. So it doesn't appear that any of the levels measured would be above the residential daytime limit. We collected background and ambient measurements from the Lisle facility as well. You can see here along the parking lot along the west side near I-88, we had several measurements that were above the residential daytime limit, but what would be considered below the commercial limit. We also collected measurements along the corner of Forbes Road and Warrenville Road that were above the limits for residential. And then as well after 8 p.m., since they're considering running evening courses, we collected measurements, and again, those measurements were high. This is just some of the locations that you can see. Along the east side, there's this is the current Glendale Heights facility. You can see along the east side, there's a middle school and high school. Along the south side, there's an apartment complex. And along the west side, there is there are single-family homes. We took measurements along all of these boundaries, and all of them were below the residential standards.
While they were in session with machines running?
While the machines were running, or the closer samples, I wanted to get closer to the building so we could have,
at the property lines.
Yes, the property lines, machines weren't necessarily running at all times, simply because I couldn't necessarily tell. But once again, if you'll go back, you can see here, that even while the machinery was running, when I'm standing at position one, which is directly next to the lab, you can see I'm just right next to the lab, and the laboratory is located in that southeast portion of that building. So it's pretty much right near one. So I'm as close as I can really be on their property to hear it. These are the sampling locations at Lisle, approximate locations. Along the roadway at Warrenville, that's where we saw elevated readings, and down there, number 11, along I-88 is where we also had elevated readings. The measurements collected from the UTI site in Glendale Heights were below the Village of Lisle ordinance daytime level of 65 decibels when measured from property boundaries. And ambient measurements collected from throughout the Lisle facility along the residential property boundary to the south were already above the Village of Lisle ordinance daytime residential level and the nighttime residential level. So based on our study, we believe that the UTI facility would comply with the Village of Lisle sound ordinance, and the ambient noise is already higher at the Lisle facility, so the UTI impact would be negligible. The next part that we contributed to was the emissions, and this is portion is regarding the permitting. According to the Illinois Department of Environmental Protection, Division of Air, the current UTI facility and the planned UTI facility are exempt from obtaining an air emissions permit. Basically, the regulations are up there on the board, but the main portion is what they would consider the UTI facility would be a general vehicle maintenance and servicing activities conducted at a source motor vehicle repair shops and motor vehicle body shops, which is listed as an exemption within the Illinois Title 35, Subtitle B, Chapter 1. And all of this information is available online at the Illinois Pollution Control Board website. Each year, the Illinois Environmental Protection Agency records ambient air quality measurements throughout the state, and the state reports these results in a report that's available online. The table below provides basically a summary of the requirements of the National and Illinois Ambient Air Standards as provided in the report. Based on this, we collected measurements to correspond to these requirements. Particulate matter of two various sizes. The larger size is something that would be considered more of an irritant size. You can breathe it in, but it's caught in your upper respiratory system. Can create coughs, etc. The smaller particulate matter is something that's going to travel deep into your lungs. We also measured for sulfur dioxide, carbon monoxide, ozone, and nitrogen dioxide. The procedure for conducting the emission sampling was that we collected measurements from the Glendale Heights facility, including throughout the property and along boundaries with the property, both baseline, again, and the worst-case measurements. And then we collected ambient measurements from the proposed Lisle facility. The following tables show results for the carbon monoxide, nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, oxygen, and ozone. Pretty much what you can tell here is that we didn't really have any measurable readings, which from where we were at positioned near the building and along the boundaries of the property, we would expect. Once again, this follows with the IEPA's judgment that this type of facility would not require an air emissions permit. The following table represents our measurements for the particulate matter. In summary, operation of the laboratory equipment did not result in a measurable change in the readings when compared with the ambient results. You can see throughout the table they are fairly similar, both worst case and the ambient at the Glendale Heights facility, and then the ambient throughout the proposed Lisle facility. And both locations are well below the National and Illinois ambient standards, where you can see down at the right-hand side of 150 for the 10 micrometer and 15 for the 2.5 micrometer. So pursuant to the Illinois Title 35, Subtitle B, Chapter 1, UTI's facility, once again, is exempt from registration as an emission source. And the air sampling results that we have support the IEPA's position that such facilities are exempt, as the UTI facility does not appear to have a measurable impact on the air quality. And based on the sampling results, we believe that the UTI facility will comply with the Village of Lisle's performance standards and state requirements regarding air emissions. The next portion that we contributed to was the fuel and hazardous materials storage. There are three levels of regulation that apply to material storage. The federal regulation is through the EPA, state regulation through the Office of the State Fire Marshal, and the Village of Lisle as well, through the Village Code. Based on these applicable codes, the planned building will be allowed up to 4 control areas on the first floor and 3 control areas on the second floor. The control area is defined as an area of the building that is subdivided by fire-rated walls, and the final building construction plans will call for the 1-hour fire-rated enclosures in the areas where they determine that these control areas will need to be set up. The following table gives a rundown of the fuel and hazardous material storage that they are anticipating at the UTI Lisle facility. Regarding diesel fuel, this is based on the number of fuel caddies that they have in order to service the laboratories. We are anticipating approximately 300 gallons of diesel fuel will be stored at the facility. This is well below the maximum allowed based on the number of control areas. Gasoline we would expect up to 625 gallons, once again, well below the allowable level based on the control areas. The other potential storage that they have, including engine oil and waste oil, engine coolant, waste coolant, gases, and other flammable liquids will also be well below what the requirements call for. The flammables will also be contained within the flammables cabinets that you would see at any typical office building where they have flammables or at a automotive repair shop. The new UTI facility will employ a full-time facilities manager. Some of the duties that the facilities manager will be charged with include maintaining the control areas, the quality control and management of the on-site fuel and chemical storage, ensuring the materials are stored properly and within the proper containment structures, and ensuring that spill protection measures are in place is one of these duties. They will also be in charge of managing the contracts of the fuel suppliers and waste disposal companies so they can once again have control over how much storage of waste and how much storage of fuel they have on site. And they will be in charge of managing storage within each control area so as to comply with the code. So in conclusion, the fuels, oils, coolants, cleaners, and compressed gases will be stored within the interior of the building and within designated control areas. The facility will maintain no more than 4 control areas on the first floor and 3 control areas on the second floor. Fuel and chemical storage within each control area will be managed not to exceed the total volume of the liquids that are applicable in the code. And the control areas will be designed with fire-rated block structures and with appropriate fire protection, ventilation, and fire and fume detection as to meet various codes. With that, I guess we have V3 again presenting.
Before we get to Mike, I'm going to go backwards a little bit here and get back to a couple that I skipped. I'm going to ask Chad Mandel from ESD to come up. Chad prepared the lighting, our photometric plan for the site.
Chad Mandel, Environmental Systems Design, 175 West Jackson, Chicago, Illinois. I do. Again, my name is Chad Mandel. I'm an electrical engineer representing the firm of Environmental Systems Design. I've been with the firm for 15 years, and Environmental Systems Design is both a national and international company. Our focus is in the areas of commercial, residential, healthcare, life sciences, institutional, educational, and mission-critical facilities. The lion's share of our work is in the downtown Chicago area and in the Chicago metro area. We were established in 1967. My work today will be focusing on the topic of site lighting. We're going to just hit on a couple of topics. We're going to take a look at the existing site plan to give a little perspective. We're going to take a look at the light levels for the parking and driveway areas. And then we're going to take a look at the type of lights that are being proposed for the site lighting and take a look at the different ordinances that apply to the work that we're doing on the site. To give a little perspective, in front of you, we're taking a look at the site as we've been discussing in the different presentations. We have Warrenville Road to the north with the service road to the north, and to the east and the west we have other commercial properties with surface parking lots, and to the south, immediately south of the property, is Interstate 88. To the south of Interstate 88 is residential. There is a wall separating the highway from the residential areas. The site lighting on the property is primarily focused on illuminating the parking areas and the driveways. The method we're using to illuminate those surfaces are poles with, in the typical case, two light fixtures mounted to each pole. You can see on the diagram they're primarily located on the medians and in some cases between the parking stalls. We, to meet the regulation of keeping our light at the property line minimal, have set back the lights off of the property line in all sides. The first ordinance that we are designing around involves the quantity of light that we're going to have on average on both the drive lanes and the parking areas. The Lisle ordinance has three different classifications: high, medium, and low activity on the site. The way it defines it is general, high being most of the parking spaces are used during the hours of 6 o'clock and later. Medium is a significant amount of parking during that same period of time. Low is based on very few parking spots being used. The day one use of the facility, in our engineering judgment, is closer to the low activity site, with the potential of maybe moving more into the medium activity site at a future date. Just as to be, in our opinion, good corporate citizens, we're designing more towards the medium activity level to provide a bit of a safer environment and provide a little more light for the occupants and the students and the teachers. The average foot light, average foot candle level, foot candle is the measure of light on a surface. So that's the primary unit used to define the amount of light on the site. Is approximately 2.6 foot candle. So we're at the upper edge of the medium activity category and actually even a little towards the high end. So we're trying to be a little conservative in the design to provide a more or less safe environment. Another two criteria that are part of the our guidelines that we're designing around is a light cutoff at the property line and the limitation of the pole heights. The ordinance actually speaks to limiting the light level at the property line where it's immediately adjacent to residential. In our case, we're not immediately adjacent to residential. However, we are designing to the more conservative guideline, and we have designed the location and the types of fixtures we're using to meet the residential ordinance, although we are actually not next to any residential. Similar to the pole heights, the poles would be limited to 26 feet if we were immediately adjacent to the property line or immediately adjacent to residential. In our case, it would be limited to 32 feet if we were immediately adjacent or if in the non-residential application. Again, we're designing around the more conservative of the two requirements, and we're limiting the top of the pole to be approximately 25 feet high. And just as a last image, we provided an image of the fixture that's being considered for the facility. Something of this nature is expected to be used. As part of the cutoff fixture classification, just as a footnote, the lamp for the fixture is buried up in the housing, so when the lamp is viewed from the side, you cannot see the lamp itself. You have to be standing more immediately below the lamp to actually see you have to be standing more below the fixture to actually see the lamp. And it's designed to limit the light spill at the property line and to residential or adjacent areas. That concludes the portion, my portion today.
Next is going to be John Mushard. He's a commercial real estate broker with Jones Lang LaSalle.
John Mushard, Jones Lang LaSalle, 200 East Randolph, Chicago 60601.
Do you sound sure that everything you say would be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening again. My name is John Mushard. I'm a managing director with Jones Lang LaSalle. We are a global provider of commercial real estate services. I've been a commercial real estate broker for 30 years. My area of emphasis has been the I-88 East-West Corridor, including the western portion of this corridor, which is defined as I-355 moving west to Aurora and Route 59. I'm here to speak about the condition of the commercial real estate market along this I-88 corridor, why the subject site has not been developed since it was vacated almost 8 years ago, and that it takes a user like UTI with special design to make this site come back alive again. In terms of my credentials, I've been typically involved in larger and more complicated transactions. I've been the broker and the team leader for transactions in this I-88 corridor, such as the Navistar World Headquarters in Lisle, which, as you well know, is 1,200,000 square feet. Computer Associates office relocation and new lease in Lisle, 80,000 square feet. Two Comcast Cable office leases in Oak Brook and Naperville, totaling 240,000 square feet. And the Office Max corporate headquarters in Naperville, which was 360,000 feet. In addition to team leadership, I'm responsible for delivering the following services to these clients. Market knowledge, available properties, both well-known and hidden along the corridor, and the knowledge of the economics behind all these transactions when they're completed. Site selection, entitlement work, financial analysis, scenario evaluation, deal negotiation, financing, architect and contractor selection, and documentation including leases, purchase and sale agreements, and construction management agreements. The question before the village is the development of 2600 Corporate West Drive. The site's been 80% vacant for 8 years, 100% vacant for 6 years, and during that entire time, it has been marketed by a commercial real estate company for sale during that period of time. In my opinion, it will continue to be vacant until a user comes by that has a specific need that cannot otherwise be satisfied in an existing office or an industrial building. And such a user, an example of that would be UTI. In examining why this site has not been developed, as an office building for a user, and in my opinion will not be for many years, the answer to that is really found in the supply and demand in this corridor. There's approximately 30 million square feet of office space in this corridor, and the vacancy is 25%. In fact, the western portion of the I-8 corridor, so 355 moving west, the vacancy has been 25% or greater since 2002. That's almost 10 years in a row. First quarter 2012 results will show that 207,000 square feet of space, more space, was put back on the market than was leased during the first 3 months again of this year. This average continuing vacancy means office users have an existing inventory of 10 million square feet to move into. The owners of these buildings are forced to compete for tenants, and as a result, they offer reduced rental rates, years of free rent, large construction allowances for interior finishes, and flexible lease terms that would allow tenants to hand back space before their lease expires, and even terminate the lease again before the lease expires. As one example, when a tenant can move into one of these existing buildings and not pay rent for up to 2 years, why would they consider building a building when none of these advantages ever exist? And again, the answer is it has to be a user with a specific need and design. To just illustrate the free rent issue, 180,000 square footer in square foot user in today's market, 1 year of free rent is worth about $4 million of payment, and 2 years is worth about $8 million of payment, and someone who builds a building would not get those advantages. The other reason for users seeking space in the market besides leasing is buying an existing building or building new. Again, the question is, why would users build new when they can buy an existing building at almost half the price? Again, the answer is they have to have a specialized need. The same economics of leasing apply here as well. The cost of developing new can be as much as double when compared to buying an existing structure. Witness the last three user purchases in this corridor of existing buildings and the associated costs. Navistar World Headquarters was purchased at $29 a square foot. When renovated, the total project costs were approximately $100 per square foot. R. Donnelly recently purchased one of the old BP buildings at Ferry and Winfield in Warrenville, 160,000 square feet, purchased for $89 a square foot, and when renovated, project costs were $135 a foot. Harris Bank recently purchased 1200 Warrenville for $98 a square foot, and when renovated, the project costs were approximately $140 a square foot. In comparison, the cost of new development today on the 2600 site, whether for office or specialized needs, is between $225 and $250 a square foot. In summary, my real estate team at Jones Lang has been involved in this project for 2 years. We spent 1 year investigating the entire Chicago market. We narrowed down our search and studied 50 properties. UTI's needs are unique. They require new construction, and that's the good news for the 2600 Corporate West Drive site, as it will take a user like UTI to get the site active and have a positive economic impact on Lisle and the surrounding community. Thank you.
All right, I think the final presentation we have this evening is Mike Retoric, who's traffic engineer with V3 Companies.
Hi, good evening. Mike Retoric, V3 Companies, 7325 Janes Avenue, Woodridge, 60517.
You sound like that everything you say will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do. Again, Mike Retoric with V3 Companies. I'm a project manager at V3, and I oversee the traffic engineering services. I'll be providing testimony on the traffic impact study that we prepared for the project. A little bit about myself. I have over 18 years of experience, a master's degree in engineering with a focus on transportation planning and traffic engineering. I'm a licensed professional engineer in the state of Illinois and four other states. I'm a certified professional traffic operations engineer with the Institute of Transportation Engineers, or ITE for short. I've completed projects in Lisle consisting of Navistar, Arbor Trails, and Arboretum Landmark, as well as several other traffic studies in the surrounding communities of Naperville, Warrenville, Woodridge, and Aurora, to name a few. A little bit about the scope of our study. Our study was was based on full build out of the site, which consists of 1,500 students and 150 faculty and staff. Since this land use doesn't quite fit a typical land use from ITE that you would typically use in a traffic study, what we had to do is we had to get an understanding of how the other campuses operate. And so in order to do that, one thing we did is we visited the Glendale Heights site and observed how, you know, arrivals and dismissals occurred at the particular site. And based off of the proposed class schedule, UTI indicated that the Dallas campus would best represent what UTI was going to do in Lisle. So we then gathered extensive data from the Dallas campus as it related to student staff schedules, number of students and staff per session, visitors, and we also got parking counts, and we did provide that information from the campus in our traffic study. We analyzed the midday and PM peak hours, which I'll get into more of that in a little bit. We analyzed the existing in year 2018 traffic conditions. So we're looking at the build out for the project is 2013. So we looked at the build out plus five. Again, that's something typical for a project of this nature. Our analysis included both Warrenville Road and the corporate West Drive access intersections. And due to the proximity of corporate West Drive and Warrenville Road, we felt it was important to understand how the operation and interaction of traffic at the intersections on Warrenville immediately impacted the intersections of corporate West Drive. The proposed access, I know this was briefly talked about at our previous meeting last month, but again, just to touch on it, the six intersections that we looked at consisted of Navistar Drive, Forbes Drive, and Cabot Drive along both Warrenville Road and Corporate West Drive. There are two proposed access for the site, both on Corporate West Drive. Those intersections were placed far enough away from Forbes Drive to minimize any potential traffic conflicts that would be that could be present at that intersection. For the purpose of this study, we focused primarily at the intersection at Forbes and Warrenville Road. We did receive some staff comments regarding our assumptions, and we'll certainly follow up with them and straighten it, you know, address any of the concerns that they would have. All the intersections of Navistar Drive and Warrenville Road and Cabot Drive and Warrenville Road are the only two signalized intersections. The rest are unsignalized. One thing to note, the intersection along Corporate West Drive are under stop sign control, but the southbound movement has the right-of-way. They're free flow. Here's this class schedule that was briefly discussed at the last meeting. Please note that the schedule is based off of full build-out. Initially, the schedule will be less as previously presented. As you can see from the table, the classes begin at 6:30 in the morning and continue on and end at 10:30 at night. The number of students for each session is presented above, and the percentages are based off of 1,200 full-time or core students and 300 elective students. Staggering the sessions among the several time periods will avoid the typical AM and PM peak hour traffic flows experienced in the area and most common with office buildings in this particular area. In fact, almost 50% of the total students will be on campus prior to 7:00 in the morning. Village staff concurred that since the peak morning commuter times for Warrenville Road occurs after 7:00, that we wouldn't be required to analyze the AM peak hour. So therefore, again, I said earlier that we focused on the midday and the PM peak hours, and you know, that again, we got the concurrence from village staff. So our trip generation, how did we accomplish this if this particular land use wasn't a typical ITE land use where we could get some trip generation data? Well, as I mentioned, this land, we made conservative assumptions We relied heavily on the information that we did get from the Dallas campus, and our conservative assumption was we arrived at one trip per student and one trip per staff member. Now, based on the data we received from the Dallas campus, that campus actually was operating on less than one trip per person. It ranged from 0.61 for the midday sessions to 0.81 during the PM session. So again, our assumptions were more on the conservative side. For the midday peak hour, we combined the exiting traffic from the AM core with the entering traffic from the midday core session. And as well for the PM peak hour, we combined the exiting people from the midday core session with the entering people and entering students for the PM core session. These estimates also included the staff arrivals and departures for the various sessions. Well, one thing to note, though, with these traffic estimates are spread out for the course of a peak hour, but the reality is that there's very little overlap with traffic circulation as it relates to the changing of the school session. So again, that's one thing to point out, where that the trip generation that we did was based off a full hour, but in reality, the sessions, there's very little to no overlap between the sessions. In our conclusions of the study, well, we analyzed the intersections. The intersection reports are based off of a level of service. There are six-letter designations ranging A to F, A being little to no delay, to F meaning excessive delays, and that the intersection is over capacity. For purposes of this study, we assume that a level of service D is the acceptable threshold, and that's typically used in DuPage County. And based on our analysis, all the intersections operate at an acceptable level of service except for the intersection of Warrenville Road and Forbes Drive. That operation, it currently exists today. It will continue to exist even with or without this project. The side street delay at Forbes may impact other intersections. Either vehicles will back up to Corporate West Drive or drivers will utilize one of the other intersections, thus increasing the impacts and delays associated with that intersection. We did receive a comment from the village staff regarding a new traffic signal at the intersection, and you know, we are prepared to have further discussions with the county. That concludes my presentation. I'll turn it back to Russ.
So that concludes our primary presentation of witnesses. We've obviously submitted a load of documents associated with the request. Presentations were based in large part on those documents. So I think you have sufficient facts in front of you right now. I'll turn it back over to you guys. I understand there's some other process to go through, and then I'll basically reserve concluding comments to the end.
Thank you. At this point, we're going to entertain public comment and general questions other than cross-examination. I've got, I believe, I was handed three different people that have signed up to speak tonight, so we'll start with them. First is Bill Habel. Sir, as I request with everyone else, would you please state your name, address for the record, and be sworn in?
Bill Habel, representing the DuPage County Building Trades, 28600 Bella Vista Parkway, Warrenville, Illinois. H-A-B as in boy, E-L.
You solemnly swear that everything you say will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do. Thank you. Good evening. As you know, millions of Americans and more than 39,000 residents and families of DuPage County continue to struggle through the pain of unemployment and underemployment. This is why I'm asking you to approve the redevelopment proposal for 2611 Corporate West Drive. The proposed $35 million investment in this property will support up to 300 construction jobs. Once the campus is operational, about 150 employees will work at the campus and will be home to 1,500 students who will spend money in our area stores, rent apartments in our community, and work in our local businesses. These are tremendous economic benefits to the community if you give your approval to this project. Given the current state of our economy, we are fortunate that a developer has proposed making this investment in Lisle. Universal Technical Institute, the national leader of automotive, diesel, and industrial technical training, will be a great addition to our corporate community. Again, I urge you to allow this wonderful career training center to be built at 2611 Corporate West Drive. Thank you.
Thank you. Richard Brink.
Richard Brink, General Manager of the Hilton Lisle Naperville on Corporate West Drive. B-R-I-N-K. I do. I come before you tonight, and thank you very much for allowing me to do so. Not so much as the General Manager of the Hilton Lisle Naperville, but a guy who's been involved in Lisle for over 20 years. Over 20 years ago when I first met my girlfriend, now my wife, and I asked her where she lived, and she said in Lisle, and I'd come down and pick her up and take her out on a date. I said, where the hell is Lisle? Well, today I know where it is for many reasons, and 16 years ago, I became even more a part of the community, being involved with the Hilton Lisle Naperville. Being as I've been involved in Lisle for over 20 years, I've seen many opportunities come and go. I've seen many businesses come and go in all forms. I was involved in the community when the office buildings were in their heyday, when the Unisys building also served as overflow for my hotel guests. I was also involved in watching buildings up and down 88 built, 100% occupied, completely empty, and totally redesigned for new tenants, or just as of today, sitting empty. Now in my role, I'm also in charge of Corporate West Drive in the Corporate West Association. So not only have I seen our own neighborhood in its heyday, but I've seen the downside as well. And I would say that today is probably, we're at the worst of the worst. You know, you can read and hear all you want on the news about the economy improving. We're not seeing it on Corporate West Drive, and we're definitely not seeing it with the former Unisys building sitting in the shape that it is. We almost bought that building about 15 years ago to turn it into a conference center. At the time, the numbers didn't quite come together, and we're very fortunate we didn't do that because the conference center industry has really dried up and gone away, henceforth why the Marriott Hickory Ridge is no longer open as well. But in my role at Corporate West Drive, I've seen that entire site slowly fade away. And the fact is today it's not anything that we could put a Band-Aid on. It's not a renovation. This property has to be started from scratch for so many reasons. I mean, and I'm not going to get into the details of the mold that's taken over the building. I mean, it looks like an episode of these cable TV shows of life without man is what is going on at that property. The opportunity before us today is one that communities across the United States are looking for. They're actively going out and looking for them. I know we have Kathy Schuster, who does an incredible job in going out and trying to find tenants for our buildings, trying to find opportunities for our vacant properties. And what we have before us now is almost could be called a gift. It's an incredible opportunity to take what is truly an eyesore, a very bad condition property, and start it from scratch. Not a Band-Aid. We're going to start it from scratch. Thank you for listening to everything being presented, because it's pretty cut and dry. We all sit in this room and we realize there's a group of people out there that aren't very happy right now because the information is pretty cut and dry. You can try to throw a monkey wrench into it, but just let's listen to the facts. I stood before you when we talked about the Navistar opportunity and said, let's stick with the facts. And I'm here today saying that's all I'm asking you to do. Review the facts, look at the opportunities, and give your approval for this project. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, sir. Gary Carfite.
Gary Carfite. Sorry, it's a tough name. K-A-R-A, F as in Frank, I-A-T. I live at 1691 Robin Lane in Lisle.
Do you solemnly swear that everything you say today will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do. Thank you. Good evening, Chairman Rigo and commissioners. I brought the official letter, Josh. I emailed this to you earlier on Tuesday, so feels good to just hand it off in person. I had two items on my calendar of significance today. This, of course, and a breakfast this morning that was an economic forecasting seminar was headlined by one of the nation's leading economists, Diane Swank, and it was hosted by Choose DuPage, the county's economic development arm, and sponsored by Ice Miller right here in Lisle, our Lisle law firm. Very distinguished panel included Dr. Bill Carroll from Benedictine University and our chairman, our DuPage County chairman, Dan Cronin. The themes were prevalent throughout of global financing, economic development, job creation, renewing our leadership role in innovation, which I thought was one of the most interesting parts of it, not only in the country and the state, but here in DuPage County. And I began to think during this forecast and discussion by the panel of our hometown here in Lisle. We are the home to one of the top arboretums on the planet. We are home to Benedictine, which now has campuses in China and Vietnam. Navistar's world headquarters are here in Lisle. And we have some of the finest hotels and corporations like Molex and other top businesses right here in our border. With your guidance and leadership, Lisle is building quite a prestigious portfolio. And UTI appears to be a great fit. The sound, emissions, lighting, traffic, real estate, everything I've heard tonight look like it pans out perfectly. So they'd be a great corporate neighbor for Lisle. But by approving this project, you demonstrate the leadership that was talked about at that seminar this morning. By approving this project, you demonstrate innovative thinking. By approving this project, you add to the business diversity of Lisle. You add jobs and you add economic development. Everything that was mentioned at today's economics summit perfectly dovetailed into this meeting. And then the top highlight of the entire meeting, Coach Mike Ditka comes up to the microphone and he ends the meeting with 15 minutes of inspirational thought. And he says, the one constant in life is that there's change. And that's exactly, this project is change. It represents positive change. And then he ended with a typical Lombardi story that only Mike Ditka could tell. And he said, when Lombardi took over the Packers, it was his job to create a new attitude, one of commitment to excellence. And I immediately thought, during the opening of tonight's hearing, you have been a positive change. This board has been a positive change in Lisle. You've been part of the new attitude, part of a new commitment to excellence. And I just want to say, approve this project and keep up that commitment to excellence. Thank you.
Thank you. Josh, was there anybody else? These were the only ones I received.
Yeah, those were the only ones that we received.
Okay, well, we'll do my typical. Hang on a second, ma'am. We'll start on my left. Is there anybody else on this side of the audience that would like to speak? Come on down, sir. Thank you. So if you just state your name for the record and be sworn in. Thank
you. Randy Hahn, 4375 Lincoln Avenue, Lisle Auto Plaza. H-A-H-N.
That everything you say will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Sorry, no fancy slides like everybody else. Everyone, thank you for your time this evening and your continued service to our community. I'm Randy Hahn. I'm the service director here at Volvo of Lisle, located at 4375 Lincoln Avenue. I've been employed there for 21 years. I've also been a Lisle resident for over 40 years. Volvo of Lisle is part of the Lisle Auto Plaza group, where we have used car superstore, Lisle Auto Plaza Body Works, Honda of Lisle, and Infinity of Lisle. We're very proud of our 40-year history in this community. We are pleased to testify in support of the relocation of Universal Technical Institute. This project is good for Lisle Auto dealers, businesses, and students, and I urge you to approve this development. I came to testify because I think my position as a service director at an area car dealer gives a unique perspective and might help you in your decision-making. As a director of Volvo of Lisle, my department is directly affected by the decision you and your trustees will make. Our dealership has a long-standing relationship with UTI and have employed over 80 UTI students, and that's just at my Volvo location. Several UTI alum remain on our staff within our network. By voting to approve this development, you would help bring needed qualified graduates to our community. Over the years, dealerships, including Volvo of Lisle, have invested in their service departments. Providing excellent customer service is essential to our dealers' continued success. We expect our new hires to act safe, courteous, and professional manner from day one. And in our experience, UTI graduates exceed this requirement. I know this because the college operates its campus like I run my service center. Being professional and courteous is key to being successful in our industry. I've been very pleased with the quality of the character of the graduates from UTI. These are serious students which may invest $30,000 to $40,000 of their own into their own education. I'm aware that the college has classroom space and an auto lab space. The auto labs are very similar to what we have at our service centers. Students work on their cars and trucks on site, just like we service our clients' cars at the dealership. Area car dealers safely operate in our community, so I think that you have a good example of how the UTI campus can fit in along the tollway from the environmental perspective. In Lisle and around the region, car dealerships are next to residential neighborhoods and commercial centers. I'd also like to recognize the skills, professionalism, and technical capabilities of not only UTI grads, but also everyone who works in the auto industry. Being an automotive or diesel technician is a noble profession and a job that provides for a lot of families. We all choose to enter the profession because it's something that we do enjoy. We don't believe there are such things as a good job or a bad job. In this economy, every job is a good job and every paycheck is a great paycheck. Everyone should be encouraged to pursue his or her own career, passions, and interests. Today's cars and trucks are complex machines. For example, our vehicles have over 30 microprocessors, complex together, controlling everything from fuel systems to Wi-Fi networks inside. Manufacturers are willing to invest millions of dollars on improving and implementing new technologies and equipment. The employees at the service center and UTI graduates must be prepared to handle all of the new products as well as the old ones. Having UTI in Lisle is an asset to our community. Area car dealers will benefit from the steady supply of qualified techs for their service departments. Businesses will benefit from new jobs, economic activity supported in the college, and its students. So as you consider to approve this project, I hope you remember that you are approving a technical school that provides its students with skills they need to be successful in their careers, and the students attending school today are entering an industry in the midst of transformational change. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anybody else on my left-hand side here of the room? On the right-hand side, Ms. Zidell. You need to be sworn in. It's a new hearing.
Mary Lynn Zadel, Z-A-J-D-E-L, 2524 Pebble Creek Drive in Lisle. I do. Good evening. I'll try and keep this to 5 minutes if I can. As you know, the Planning and Zoning Commission's job is different than the job of the Board of Trustees. Your job is to only recommend approval of a special use permit under findings of fact, and that to verify by an exhaustive study of the facts whether or not the project meets the requirements outlined in the code. The criteria in the code is that this use is necessary for the public convenience at this location. That criteria must be found to be met with fact. A special use can only be recommended by this board if that fact is proven to be true. There is no requirement in the Village Code for a Planning and Zoning Commission to show factors related to economic development, economic impact, number of objectors, number of supporters, jobs being relocated from Glendale Heights to Lisle. You don't need to worry about 200,000 square feet being vacated in Glendale Heights. It's not part of what you need to consider. You don't need to consider 187 vehicles being moved from Glendale Heights to Lisle. That's not part of what you're here to do. You're here to prove that this use is necessary for the public's convenience at this location. So there's three key parts to this. One, that it's necessary. Two, that it's for the public's convenience. And three, this exact location. First, let's just talk about that need part. The applicant would have you believe, per their submitted findings of fact, that the affluent areas of Naperville and Lisle need an alternative, a career program that serves high school students who do not go on to traditional four-year programs. Since there is so much emphasis in Naperville and Lisle on following a traditional four-year program, they would have you believe that a corporation must come to Lisle, Naperville, to this exact area on Warrenville Road in an OR district to meet the need for those students who want to choose an alternative path other than a four-year college. Really? Do they really think that an intelligent person will buy into that argument? Let me put this another way. The applicant, a publicly traded for-profit corporation, wants intelligent people to believe that their shareholders want a company to relocate to an area with the least demand. Are there needs for high school students who reside in Lisle to choose an alternative four-year, an alternative to a four-year program? Is there a need? Is there an unmet need for Lisle residents who are high school students who want an alternative program to a four-year college? Is there an unmet need? I say no, there's not. Because we have COD. College of DuPage is the largest single-campus community college in the country outside of the state of California. More than 25% of all high school students within the districts, meaning the entire COD district, more than 25% of all of the high school students go to COD at some point. Each semester, there are 31,000 students that attend COD. The Glen Ellen campus, conveniently located to Lisle, covers 273 acres, 11 major buildings. COD offers more than 90 certificate programs and degrees for today's occupational and technical careers. They offer 9 associate degrees in 59 occupational and 45 transfer programs. COD also maintains a library open to the public with a collection of over 245,000 books, 285,000 microfiche, nearly 30,000 video recordings, and more. College of DuPage's primary source of operating revenue is our property tax. COD levied $106 million in property tax in 2011. Annually, DuPage County taxpayers provide $106 million to COD because we believe this is important. COD has net assets of $375 million. $375 million. This includes land, buildings, and equipment. This is an increase of over 80. I'm doing my best.
I'm going to ask you to wrap it up, please.
Yeah, I understand. The net assets of COD as a single-campus community college exceeds the market cap of UTI's all 11 campuses. COD is a very large, significant resource that meets the needs of Lisle students who are seeking an alternative path to a four-year college. A majority of county voters have valued COD's alternative educational and training programs as necessary for the convenience of our residents, so much so that numerous bond referendums have passed. Just a year and a half ago, voters supported a $168 million bond referendum for the construction and expansion at COD. DuPage taxpayers now carry the burden of over $200 million in debt that supported the expansion and construction at COD. Let me review. We provide $108 million annually to COD. They have a $345 million net asset, and we have over $200 million in debt to support COD because we think it's important, and it provides the need that we're asserting is needed here. Earlier this week, newspapers reported that Illinois Senator Durbin said, "Community colleges are the key. We have to warn high school students about being diverted into for-profit schools that many times are worthless. They end up telling them all they're accepted, and they end up not training them." Okay, I have like 2 paragraphs. The use that's proposed by UTI, especially if it's funded with TIF funds, is not necessary for the public convenience at this location. Lisle taxpayers have already invested a tremendous amount of money in COD. They've expanded, they're growing. Ask this question: where is UTI going to relocate if you say no? What will UTI do if you approve this and the TIF is denied? Who's going to ask that question? What are the alternate plans? What is Plan B? What are they telling their stockholders? Are they telling their stockholders that it's absolutely necessary to relocate the Midwest campus from Glendale Heights to 2611 Corporate West Drive? No, actually, they're not. In their SEC filings, UTI is telling their shareholders that they anticipate enrollment to continue falling. UTI is telling their shareholders that they're containing costs because student loan regulation at a federal level is tightening up. A use for a for-profit automotive technology school is not necessary in Lisle. And because it's not necessary for the public convenience at this location, which is an absolute factual requirement of a special use in Lisle, it can't be approved because it doesn't meet the test. We don't need to listen to all sorts of arguments about jobs and economy or anything else, because your job is to make sure that it meets the test, and it doesn't. It's just that simple. And so that's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Adele. Anybody else on this side of the room?
Good evening. Committee, my name is James Harkness, H-A-R-K-N-E-S-S. I am a resident and businessman in Lisle. Would you like my business address or would you like my residence?
Your residence.
I do. 6072 Ironwood Lane, Lisle, Illinois, 60532. I would like to congratulate you because you have attracted an opportunity. You've attracted an opportunity to solve a problem for me, for my child, for all of us here in Lisle, and you've attracted an opportunity that's unique. I listened with interest. I don't want to regurgitate what people have said, but the last purchase opportunity was, I thought I heard 15 years ago, might have been five. You've heard that this is a unique and specific use area. You've heard that since 2004, this site, you haven't heard it in these words, but I have the unique opportunity to give you my opinion because I've only looked at the press releases as a Lisle citizen, but I came here for a very specific purpose, and it was for this opportunity. The research and development corridor was developed for a specific purpose, and you heard that that specific use since 2004 has been not only vacant and vacating, but declining. You have 236,000 square feet that's decreasing in value. It's a blight on our community. It's creating a problem. And what is it doing for our citizens? What problem is it solving? What are you doing? What's your purpose today? It's solving that problem. And you have a school that wants to move in and create jobs and have 1,500 students that are productive citizens that can get jobs in an economy where people are dropping out of graduate schools, they're dropping out of colleges because they're not going to be employable. These people are employable. There's going to be dedicated staff, full-time employees working there. The estimate is 150 of them on top of the 1,500 students. You have in the Arboretum Village a preservation of landscape. You have a proposal for mature tree preservation. You have a proposal to comply with stormwater requirements. You have, from what I heard, compliance with lighting, traffic, environmental requirements. You have being handed to you exactly what we heard about in the primary. You have economic development, economic stimulation. You have growth, positive growth, that takes what is a brownfield problem for Lisle and is a complete redevelopment of a site, a tear down and redevelopment of a new state-of-the-art facility that solves problems. I don't want to pay for that. We have a productive corporate citizen that's willing to do it. Does that serve a unique need? Yes. Does it serve a purpose? Yes. Do intelligent people believe that that's going to solve our problem? Yes. It's generating jobs. It's curing our problem. You have not been able to remedy this problem. It's been happening since 2004. The cure, the proposal is here. It's not detrimental. It's not harmful. In fact, what I'm reading is that it's $35 to $50 million in direct and indirect economic benefit. And it's people here, citizens that want to come to downtown Lisle. They want to come to the businesses here. They want to work for the companies like Navistar that are here, and they're willing to come to school here to do it. My question to you isn't, why do you see a problem with this? Why would you turn it down? I don't want to pay for it. More importantly, I don't want my son to pay for tearing down that building and dealing with a brownfield problem that we can solve now that a responsible corporate resident wants to solve. They want to preserve the landscape there. They want to preserve the mature growth there. They want to deal with the stormwater problems, and they want to redevelop the building. Please do it. Please support it.
Thank you very much. Anyone else going up on this side? All right, at this point, we're going to take about a five-minute break. It's about 8:25. We're going to reconvene at 8:30, and we're going to get through the rest of our meeting tonight. So if you just give us 5 minutes, we're going to take a five-minute break, and we'll reconvene at 8:30. Thank you. All right, we're back. Before we close our public comment section, I'm going to make sure there's nobody on this side left. All right, so during the day today, staff provided the commission with 11 letters from members of the community. I'm just going to kind of list off what we received and give the general gist of what they were about. I want to just note this for the record. We received a letter from the Hilton of Lisle, Naperville, WorkNet DuPage, Fair Oaks Ford, Continental Acura of Naperville, Lisle Auto Plaza, Harley Davidson of Lisle, Prager, Marquette Property Management, Marquette Management, and Cisco Construction Industry Service Corporation. 10 letters. I'm not going to read any of them in the record. I'm just going to notate that we received these for the record in favor of this, voicing their support of this project. We also received an email from a Ms. Julie Schnell outlining her opposition to the to this project. I believe all members of the commission received these today, correct? Yes. So notate for the record that the commission received these. We want to make these all part of the record. At this point, we have our cross-examination. I think we have two individuals that have registered to cross-examine. I'm not sure what order you want to go in. It's Ms. Barbara Erkman and Mr. Brian McClure. It's up to you which way you want to do this. You want to come down and be sworn in, and we'll go over a couple of the ground rules.
Yes. Okay, I'm Barbara Erkman. My address is 24 West, 430 Warrenville Road, and that's in Naperville. I am a 45-year resident of the area and reside about 1,300 square feet from the proposed UTI.
1,300 linear feet, I believe.
Pardon me?
1,300 linear feet.
Linear feet, yeah. Okay.
Okay, Ms. Erkman, I just want to remind you, we had an exchange via email, and I just want to remind you and just state for the record, you know, we discussed kind of the scope of what's going to happen tonight. I gave you up to 30 minutes. I know you and Mr. McClure, I believe, talked. So I don't know if you need the whole time. You've got it if you need it. Just so you try and keep your cross-examination strictly pertaining to how UTI's proposed use of the subject property impacts your personal residential property value and how their use of the subject property impacts your quiet use and enjoyment of the residential property. With those two caveats, the floor is yours. You can ask whichever witness you'd like to cross-examine at the time. And I ask the witnesses to come up. Please use the microphone because everything's being recorded. And the floor is yours, Ms. Erkman.
Okay. The first witness would be Ms. Condon. And I have one question for her. Okay. Regarding the fuel storage on the property, you noted the amount of the fuel storage. But how much will be burned, and how often is the fuel storage refilled?
I can't necessarily speak to specifically the amount of usage. That would probably be more what the UTI instructors would be able to answer that.
Okay.
I do know that typically they fill an engine and run it as necessary for that training period of class time.
Is that daily or every day or twice a day?
It varies. Depending on the course. And again, an instructor would be able to answer that question accurately.
Okay. So would there be an instructor there who could just answer a simple question, how much fuel storage will be burned and how often the fuel storage is refilled?
We have the witnesses all here that have testified. You can only ask questions of people who have testified.
Well, would that be somebody from UTI?
You can ask. I can't answer for them,
well,
ma'am.
Is there somebody here?
Is Ms. Condon, is Ms. Condon excused?
Yes. Thank you very much. So there's nobody who can answer that question?
Ms. Erkman, can you elaborate as kind of what you're trying to get at?
Well, I'm trying
I think I know where you're going. I want you to go ahead.
I'd like to know, first of all, how much fuel will be stored. We know. How much will be burned? Or how much? I mean, this is going to be going into the air potential air pollution situation. Often is the fuel storage refilled, trucks coming in and out? That will definitely impact me, and I'm interested.
Okay.
I think it's a valid question. Okay. So who would be able to answer that?
I'd just like to remind you that we did have testimony tonight that they meet the Illinois EPA requirements.
Mm-hmm. But specifically, how often is the fuel storage refilled?
But I don't know how that's relevant to your use of your personal property.
Traffic coming in, more traffic, that would definitely increase the traffic.
We had testimony the first night regarding that. I know you weren't here, and your mother was here for part of it.
I did 1 hour and 37 minutes watched it. And the 420 pages that I received on a disc, I haven't read every single line, but I've more than reviewed. So
I believe it was stated that it was minimal. And that the numbers that, and if I remember the testimony correctly, the numbers mm-hmm. that were given to us were maximums that they'd never have met. But they're maximums allowed. And I believe the testimony of Ms. Condon tonight actually spoke to that these are the limits, but a couple of the numbers, I believe, were a fourth of the limits that she spoke to tonight. If that doesn't answer your question, I don't know what else I can do. I would ask the petitioner if there's anybody that can answer this question, but I think we've had enough testimony on this.
Yeah, I don't think I followed up with UTI. I don't think we have someone that we've presented that could specifically speak to how much is used on a daily or weekly basis.
Okay. So we'll have to take that under consideration as a commission.
Well, there's 183 vehicles, I believe, in the building, according to the reports and the testimony tonight. So I'm just curious. That seems like a lot of...
Ms. Erkman, this is your chance to cross-examine witnesses, okay?
Okay. I'm just stating...
The whole public...
Then I'll be moving on to the traffic study. And I just have several questions, and then I will end it. First, I have a question regarding the consultant who reviewed the report and made several recommendations. Have you made any notations or comments on those recommendations? Specifically, the basis that the assumption of that 50% of the traffic comes east on Warrenville and west, 50% from the west. It was an assumption. And the person who actually reviewed that did not agree with that.
Yeah,
how would you comment on that?
We did. We wanted to get through the public hearing process, mm-hmm. at least this meeting, before following up with them. What we did for our analysis was looked at a worst-case scenario at Forbes Drive as regarding the 50-50 split. Again, you know, we will follow up with them, but basically the distribution was based off of the access to and from the interstate and the surrounding area.
Sir, can I ask you to elaborate on what you mean by worst-case scenario? I mean, it's part of this. This is to help us. So what do you mean by worst case scenario?
Well, basically, you can look at it as there's three intersections along Warrenville Road that you can access the site. Those are signalized intersections. Again, Navistar and Cabot with Warrenville Road, signalized intersections. At times, especially maybe during the PM peak hour, they could be attractive and as a means for access, just because it stops traffic on Warrenville Road and allows you to make maneuvers unopposed. So what we wanted to do was look at an isolated intersection. If most students, primarily if you Google the property, it'll tell you to come in on Forbes Drive. So we wanted to focus primarily on Forbes Drive, knowing that in reality, some people will be utilizing the other intersections to enter and exit the site. So therefore, we could have looked at it as a even split across the three intersections, but We did not. We wanted to. We just wanted to.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. Your report on the ITI trip generation said this was not typical for this type of use, but in this ITE, does it include data for colleges, universities, or any kind of community college?
It does have data. The data is somewhat limited regarding the number of studies that were conducted. But if you look at the designated class schedule for mm-hmm. this particular use, it is unique. Therefore, for those two reasons, we had to rely heavily on existing operations. Again, that's, as I testified, it is, you're right, it in the ITE, it's not a typical land use. Again, as what usually happens is when that isn't the case, you have to look for alternative methods to do your analysis.
Well, how would this compare to an office use, for example?
Well, for an office use?
I have the reports here.
Nope. First of all, the sessions are spread out over five sessions, so as far as the intensity of traffic in and out of the site, it's not comparable to an office, just for some reference numbers. A site of this size, you can fit a 435,000 square foot office building. And just for some comparisons, the PM peak hour would generate 648 trips for that. So as you can see in what I testified, that is more than what is expected at this site.
In the report, it says that there are 742 cars that will be entering the proposed site early in the AM, like 6:30 to 7, I believe.
For the two sessions,
yeah.
Yes.
Prior to the peak traffic hour, what is the peak traffic hour of Warrenville Road? It didn't really specify.
We did specify it in the report. It starts at 7:15 to 7:30.
7:15 to 7:30.
And that's okay. The peak commuter time on Warrenville Road.
Okay.
And that's based off of...
How do you know that that's the...
Well, for the work, the work we've done in the past, we have current... We have traffic counts from 1 to 2 years old that we got that information from.
Okay. And what is the impact to the AM peak traffic?
Well, again, the AM session occurs prior to the commuter traffic. So obviously there's less traffic on the road, and again, the project impacts are minimal.
Okay. The traffic study is based on a 1% growth per year to 2018, with 2013, the build-out of the project. It's the five-year. What accommodations were made to account for any vacant buildings, office buildings specifically, in the nearby area?
For this study, none.
Okay. Did you know how many?
Ms. Erkman?
Yes.
This is specific to your residential property, correct?
Well, I would, yes.
Okay, in what way? You live on Pebble Creek, it doesn't enter Warrenville.
Well, if I'm wondering the growth of the traffic, if there's other office buildings that come in, they're empty now, do we take into account people are going to be moving into these office buildings?
I would talk to your state representative and county board members, because this corridor was built out a long time ago. So would your argument be that any new office building?
My question was, I wanted to know if that was included in the traffic study.
Well, he answered.
Okay, so I got my answer. Okay, and I'm almost finished here. What is the impact of the intersection of Warrenville and Lisle, or Warrenville and Naperville Road? Did you look at these two intersections, and were they included in your study?
We did not look at those intersections.
And why not?
Primarily for a project of this nature, typically you look at the access points to and from the site. We discussed it with village staff prior to conducting the study, and they concurred with our study area.
Okay, winding up here, when and how often are vehicle deliveries made, and what is the impact on the traffic?
That wasn't part of our study.
Not part of the study, okay.
Not part of our study.
And then my final question, do the students or faculty test drive vehicles on the streets? If so, impact on traffic?
That wasn't part of the scope of our study.
I mean, I just, you know, I'd like to comment, 183 vehicles in the building, and I'm sure they will be test-driven at some point. And it's not even the amount of traffic, it's Who's driving these vehicles?
Ma'am, that's you're not cross-examining anymore.
I'm just making a comment.
I understand, but that time was...
I know, and then I am finished. Thank you so much for allowing me the chance to do this. I appreciate it, and thank you to all the people I questioned.
Mr. McClure, the floor is yours. Go ahead. Good evening, Mr. McClure. Can you be sworn in first, and then we're going to go over a couple ground rules?
I do.
And you have his name and address?
I do. Brian McClure, 2248, Hidden Creek Court, Lisle.
Mr. McClure, I'll remind you, as I reminded Mr. Rickman before, your cross-examination must strictly pertain to how UTI's proposed use of the subject property impacts your personal residential property value, this being your primary residence where you live within the village, and your cross-examination must strictly pertain to how UTI's proposed use of the subject property impacts your quiet use and enjoyment of your residential property. With those two caveats, the floor is yours.
Yes, and I would like to state that I coordinated with Barb Berkman. She ceded the additional time that she did not use to me, and I want to make note that the commission asked questions during her time just in case I ran out of time.
Well, you've got 30 minutes starting right now.
Well, that's typical. Okay, I'd like to call Ms. Conan up. Ms. Conan, are you an air quality engineer?
No, I am not.
Do you consider yourself an air pollution specialist?
No.
Have you ever prepared an emissions report in applications for regulatory approval for air quality?
No.
Okay. Did you supervise this air quality study?
I conducted the air sampling. My environmental manager, Dave Kwasaborski, is technically my supervisor.
So what qualifies you to do any type of testing? If you're not an expert, if you are not a professional licensed expert?
I don't believe there are professional licensed experts as far as a lot of the sampling goes. I do have 8 years of experience in the environmental field, including air sampling.
Did you ever take any formal courses in air sampling?
No. Formal courses during my college education, no.
Actually, there are licensed professionals who do that. They're acoustical engineers. I noticed in your report that you say that when you tested the air, there was a 20-mile-an-hour gust. Which direction was that going? East, west, north, south?
Unless it's stated in the report, I do not recall.
Okay. Did you write that report?
I did.
So you can't remember which way it was going?
Based on my memory, it was to the south, southeast.
Okay. And what time of day was that?
That particular gust, I'm not certain.
Mr. McClure, can you laser beam your...
The wind blows north, south, east, west. It hits directly on where I live. It affects the property value of my house. And I need an expert to tell me what the sound is. And so if we're not testing, if we're not a professional, and we didn't take into account which way the wind blows, this is very important to me.
I would like to note that sound dissipates significantly with distance. We did do some estimates based on if one of the... Along the southern edge of the commercial property, if they generated, say, a level 65, the residents located south of I-88 would feel approximately a 35 decibel range, and that would not include the road noise in between those two places.
What was the ambient noise at Route 88 at the time?
It would be in the report.
Hang on, Ms. Condon. Mr. McClure, how far away do you live from this site?
My house is 2,400 feet.
And the testimony tonight, if I understand, I want to make sure I understand this correctly, was at the perimeter, What you've told us
at
the perimeter.
At the perimeter,
there is negligible
from the current facility.
Okay, so how does that affect you?
Because it was at Glendale Heights, which wasn't here.
No, but she testified.
It was in Texas, which wasn't here, and it was at a different time of year than all year long. And I need to know what it is, because I went through this with Navistar. So I recognize that from 6:30 in the morning till 10:30 at night, there's going to be sound coming from that building. There's going to be backup.
Mr. McClure, you're 2,400 feet away from the building. She has testified to us tonight, and we have to take her testifying her oath.
You know what? This is my ability to cross-examine.
But I'm going to limit it, as I told you, and I'm going to keep you kind of focused on the quiet enjoyment use of your property.
And that is the quiet enjoyment use, because I open my windows at nighttime, and I can hear Route 88, and I need to know what the ambient noise plus the noise from backup beepers.
Is he still going to hear Route 88?
Yes.
Is this building going to add any ambient noise to what he already hears from Route 88?
It appears to be negligible.
Okay.
How many engines were running when you did your test?
Can I want to state the objection on behalf of the petitioner for the record. We're talking with cross-examination, we look to unique and specific property interests. Mr. McClure has already testified that he lives 2,400 feet from the property. When we look at the Zoning Enabling Act, we talk about 250 feet, and those are people that are automatically granted a unique right. We've testified extensively today that there's no impact, that we meet village requirements, and I don't think Mr. McClure is able to substantiate that he has any unique interest here.
I understand, sir, your objections noted for the record. Mr. McClure is trying
for the record, I'd like to state that I don't have a professional.
Well, that's your
that
opinion.
That has
sir, look,
done
if you're
going to
argue, we'll cut this off right now.
I'm telling
ask
you right
your
now.
Questions, ask your questions in a respectful manner.
I am.
In a non-condescending manner.
You are the one that's doing this. I'm just asking her questions.
Well, I'm going to ask you to move on.
How many engines were running when you tested the noise of the school? They have up to 183 engines. How many were running on the day that you tested the school?
I am not certain of the number of engines, but it was a typical class time. They do not run all engines, from what I've been told, during a typical class time.
Who told you that?
The instructors, and based on observations that I had while I was at the facility.
So which instructors did you talk to? The engine testing instructors?
The instructors of the courses during the tour that we took and that were running the courses while I took samples.
How many did they tell you actually run during the course of a day?
I do not recall the exact number.
Do any vehicles have backup beepers on them?
I do not know that. That's not part of my study.
Okay, if a truck backs up, and they do have backup beepers, does that have additional
noise?
I'm
going to object again. He lives 2,400 feet from the property. A backup beeper is never going to be heard 2,400 feet from the property. We're way beyond the scope of any unique property interest he has here.
I might say that, you know what, I am a citizen of Lisle, and you say that I don't represent anybody else, but I do speak for the people of Lisle. I mean, we deserve
Mr. McClure, you speak for yourself.
To have information.
You speak for yourself.
And I
tonight.
Speak for a number of other people.
You speak for yourself.
On the record, I speak for a lot
you
of people.
One more time to please move on. I'm going to beg you to move on.
On his point, though, I want to state for the record again that all of the people of Lisle do not have a right to cross-examine.
I understand.
Cross-examination is based on unique property rights.
I understand.
In your report, you switch from DBs to DBA. Can you tell me the difference between those two?
Yes, it is explained in the report as well.
Mm-hmm.
excuse me. A decibel is just the direct reading. The DBA would be over, I'm sorry,
I think the significant thing about this is you left the units off of this report, so I don't know what you're talking about.
It's basically over a period of time versus an immediate exposure, an immediate reading.
Okay. In your opinion, will the sound, you say that 88 hits my house, and it does, Does ambient noise connected to additional noise dissipate more or less? Will I hear more or will I hear less at my house if it combines with 88?
You wouldn't ever be able to tell the difference, really. It would be negligible.
Okay.
I'm going to object again and say it's irrelevant whether he can hear more or less noise. What's relevant is whether or not we meet the standards in the Lisle Ordinance, and she's already testified to the fact that we meet the standards of the Lisle Ordinance. So for the purposes of this commission, it doesn't matter whether he can hear more or less. What matters is whether we're going to
exceed... Is this taking my time?
Whether we're going to exceed...
Okay,
You can't. He has a right to object.
Okay.
You've made statements...
Do I have a right to object when things are said?
You've made statements that over and
over
again.
Did you test the houses at the house level? Did you go to the house level and test the noise?
I did not go onto private property.
Okay, so if we weren't on private property, how do we know what the noise was? How do we know what it is if you didn't test it?
We tested at the residential boundaries as is required by the village ordinance.
Okay. I'd like to move to the air pollution section of this. Are you an air quality engineer?
No, I'm not.
Do you consider yourself an air pollution specialist?
No.
Have you ever prepared an emission report application for regulatory approval?
No.
In your study, you stated that you tested... none less than 3 microns, 3 to 10. Why is that?
I believe it's 0.3 microns,
3. Mm-hmm.
To 10. That is the limit of measurement of the instrument.
Okay. And you're aware that 3 microns to 10 is easily... filtered out by a human body?
Actually, up to 10 microns is something that is caught in the upper respiratory system and actually can be an irritant causing cough,
mm-hmm.
Nasal irritations, that sort of thing.
Except it's filtered. But anything under 3 is the carcinogenic nanoparticles or fine particulate matter which cause the health risks for anyone who breathes them in.
The 2.5 micron and below is something that can get into your lower
exactly.
respiratory system.
Exactly. So why didn't you test that?
We did. We tested between the range of 0.3 to 10, and 2.5 is included within that range.
Mr. McClure, I might want to remind you that I think we had testimony on the record under oath that this meets all of IPA's requirements. So if there's an issue with emissions, I guess you talk to the IEPA. I mean, I have to take... what was given under oath tonight is the truth.
So,
and it meets IEPA's
She's not an engineer, and she testified that this meets its requirements.
We follow the recommendations that are provided to us by the IEPA.
I believe she's qualified to make
What qualifies you to make those recommendations?
My experience performing air testing.
But you don't have a professional degree in...
In air testing? No, I do not.
Okay. But there are licensed professionals... professional
sir, she gave us her
engineers who do that
and her company's credentials. We're not here to argue about credentials.
Okay.
I don't see how her credentials affect your private property interests.
On page 28, you say that the national Illinois standard for ozone is 75 parts per billion or 75 parts per million. Is that correct? Let's go to page 28 right here.
The difference between the ozone readings that you're looking at, your question specifically was...
I'm going to object.
Right here.
Our studies showed that there was no reading coming out of the facility. So if there's no measurable reading, how can we possibly have an impact on his property, which again is 2,400 feet away?
Because
noted.
The nanoparticles travel for hundreds of miles. And that's what causes cancer for my 5-year-old daughter, or for me, or for older people, or the people in Lisle. This report is wrong. This is 0.075 parts
sir,
per million.
Sir, stop for a second, please. Go ahead.
For the record, there's been no testimony as to what causes cancer, how things travel, how far they travel, or what impact they're going to have on any human. So, I mean, anything he's saying in this commentary is completely unsubstantiated. I don't believe Mr. Kluwer has any of the licensing he's suggesting that Lisle should have. So any qualification to make those statements, I would certainly question.
Understood. And noted for the record.
This is actually supposed to be 0.075, isn't it? Because this would be 10 times higher than the...
Why are you assuming that that is the case?
Because the National Illinois Standard for Ozone is 75 parts per billion. This is 10 times higher. This would be 1,000 times more.
Either way...
Sir, if there's a typo in the report...
Our measurements were not detected.
I understand, but this is wrong. This is not.
Then
this
I
is
apologize
not,
for the typo.
Sir, this has nothing to do with your property interest, does it?
You know what this does? Yes, it does.
Well, okay, explain.
Because my daughter lives in my house. My daughter is going to be breathing the air that comes from this building. We didn't test the autos. We didn't test the number of trucks. We don't know how long they run. We don't know what there is. I know that there's a lot of cars. I'm not worried about the cars. I'm worried about the diesel fuel exhaust, the deadliest fuel exhaust on the planet. That affects me.
Well,
it travels
to
my house.
I strongly suggest you talk to the IEPA then.
I don't need
to
talk to them.
They've given this exempt. This building's exempt.
And does that mean that a school is exempt or that it says repair shops are exempt and that auto repair shops, this is a school?
We had testimony. We've had evidence presented that this use, as described, complies with the exemption. Okay? If you have a problem with that, I strongly suggest you take it up with a different body.
I recognize that you don't, but I do. Asking the questions.
Who says I don't? You can't answer for me.
Because you've told me that a million times, that I'm wrong about that. You did it in Navistar, it now.
Sir, I'm not even going to respond. I'd ask you to move on. You've gone through about half your time, close to it.
I also want to object to some of the representations that were made there. I believe that there was testimony presented in the first evening as to what period of time students were in labs. So while we may not have testified to exactly how long a vehicle may be running, I believe there was testimony. Mr. McClure was not here for that testimony, but there was testimony regarding the use of the vehicles in those labs and the duration of labs.
You testified that you aren't aware how many engines run at one time, right?
Correct.
Would you agree that engine exhaust has an exposure to the air quality?
Engine exhaust
at my house, 2,400 feet away?
The direct impacts were not part of our study, other than what measurements were suggested by the IEPA and what that they would consider as air quality standards.
I think we've had plenty of testimony on that subject. Sir,
would you agree that my question was, would you agree that there is an exposure 2,400 feet away at my house with the exhaust coming from the engines that are running at the school, yes or no?
I don't believe that there would be a measurable impact from the UTI facility on your home.
Okay, and you state that as a non-professional licensed air quality engineer.
She states it in capacity as a person testifying in support of this petition.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's just leave it at that, okay? Please be a little bit respectful, this lady. All right, have a little respect.
Did you write this report, Lisle?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Have you written any other reports like this?
I write reports for a living.
Okay. So why did you use two digits when the standard is 0.075 parts per million? Would your entries be different if you used the
I object. We've
figures.
We've already gone through this.
I agree.
It's been discussed.
Your objection's noted. Please move on.
She didn't answer the question.
She answered it earlier, and if it's a typo, it's a typo.
She didn't answer the question. I want to know if it would be different. Would it not be different. Okay. In your professional opinion?
Yes. The limit of detection on the meter was significantly below that.
Okay, but it didn't measure the nanoparticles or fine filament particles that would be coming from this.
I can't attest to the machine's capabilities for measuring nanoparticles.
Okay. Are you aware of the air quality in Lisle? Did you test that to start with? Did you take a look at, is our air quality below or above EPA standards today?
I did test. I collected ambient air measurements in Lisle.
Is it below or above?
And it's included in the report. They are below the national standards and Illinois EPA standards.
Okay, but the city of Lisle is above, so I don't know how they came below. I mean,
what are you basing?
It's provided in a report that was. It is available online, and you can look at it.
Okay.
The pollution control website.
I did. I mean, I looked at Lisle. We're above the standards, and the standards are being lowered.
Sir,
I'm going to object to that. There's been no testimony. There's been nothing submitted to substantiate that Lisle's above. In fact, we have a report that says that measurements show that the readings on the site are well below those standards.
Thank you, and noted.
Okay. I'd like to move on. Thank you.
You've got approximately 10 minutes.
I'd like Brian Udall, please. Brian, your testimony, you testified that, you know.
I'm going to object. Mr. McClure wasn't here for his testimony.
Yes, I was.
You were.
And I also got
to
see
it. He can watch it.
I'm not going to
lie to objection. You can go ahead and question Mr. McClure.
You stated that at Glendale Heights you've had 25 successful years, and you've been there for 25 years.
I said approximately 25 years.
Right. Do you consider the level of police calls successful at that location?
The level of police calls to the UTI campus?
Yes.
I'm going to object. I don't think there's been anything entered into the record with respect to police calls. There was a separate case in which police calls were discussed, but that case is not before us, so we have nothing on the record with respect to police calls.
I would agree. I mean,
Mr. Udall is testifying for UTI.
I understand, but Mr. McClure, we have no evidence to the record regarding that for this hearing.
Are you aware of any police calls at your school in Glendale Heights?
I don't operate at the Glendale Heights. My office is not there, so I am not aware.
Why is it important for you to get licenses of students coming to UTI, their driving records?
Because their driving records are used to help them get into the postgraduate programs, the MSAT programs. Mm-hmm. They're also used to when they're accepted into or when they participate in elective programs.
Mm-hmm.
And it's part of professionalism, and we encourage our students to, once they get out and they get jobs with dealerships, then dealerships focus on their driving records.
Mm-hmm. Most of these students live in apartment complexes around the locations that...
I really can't speak to where the students live.
Okay. If a student has a bad driving record, do they have any type of restrictions from driving?
By the school or by law enforcement?
Yeah, no, by you.
Sir, can you help the commission out with where this is going and how this affects
Well, if I was you? Coming out of Lisle Road onto Warrenville and someone ran into my car because they had a bad driving record, I'm just interested if they, you know, maybe police
that. I'll give you a little bit. Go ahead.
Okay. It could affect you, too. It could affect your kids. They're going to be driving someday. My kids drive. I mean, they went through it.
Go ahead.
So the question is,
if they have a bad driving record, does that student not get into UTI, or do you just, you know, are students accepted into UTI? If they have, say, 3 speeding tickets or, you know, a bad record?
students are not accepted into UTI if they have a felony.
Okay, so driving record isn't a felony.
Right.
Okay. Who tests the vehicles? Do the students or do the teachers?
What do you mean by test?
Well,
test,
when you repair a vehicle, where do you test drive it? I mean, who test drives it?
Well, typically at a campus, our students will, our instructors will plant a bug in the engine or in the vehicle.
Okay.
And then our students will hook their diagnostic equipment to the vehicle.
Okay.
And then students will start the vehicle or to test the vehicle to test what problem the vehicle has. And then once the student has diagnosed the problem, then they will shut the vehicle down. They will repair the bug. They'll fix the problem. Then they will hook the diagnostic equipment back to the vehicle. They will start it for a brief period to again test the fix, and then they will turn the vehicle off and disconnect the diagnostic.
So you don't
equipment.
Have outside vehicles being brought in. You have all your own vehicles that they repair.
Most of the vehicles referenced earlier are clip cars, so they can't even be driven on the street anyway.
Okay.
But we do not test drive our vehicles on the public roadways.
Good, good. Do you have any idea how many vehicles run at a time if you have 183 vehicles?
I can't say accurately how many vehicles at a time.
Is there any?
It all depends on what class it is and where the students are in their program and learning objectives are being taught that day.
Okay. Do you have any type of scrub equipment that would take care of fine particulate matter?
I can't speak to how the carbon monoxide system works.
Okay. Okay. Just two more questions. Is there anything, if this was approved, is there anything that would stop you from moving into this location? I mean, is it pretty much a given that you'll move in if this is approved?
If I don't understand how that is relevant to property, to unique property interests, whether or not they decide to move has nothing to do with the land use matter before
the TIF has everything to do
and that is not the subject matter of this
tonight. Hang on, I'll take care of this. This commission has absolutely nothing to do with the TIF process.
I understand. I just want to know if the TIF doesn't pass, is this, are you going to move in anyway?
I don't think it's the proper time to be even discussing that. We have no control over that process. This board,
I understand, and I'm just asking, if he knows, if the TIF wasn't passed, would you still move in?
I object. I'm going to tell him not to answer that.
That's fine.
It has nothing to do with the land use decision before this board.
That's fine.
No problem. You don't want to answer that?
No, I'm not going to answer that.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you. At this point, we have no subpoenaed witnesses. Are there any non-petitioner presentations?
No, I forgot. I have one more person that Barb didn't take that I need to take. Do I have about 5 minutes left?
You got about three.
Good. Tom Udall, please. I forgot all about it.
Did you ask for me again?
No.
Yeah, I thought you did.
No. I have an entire... You're Brian. Not you, Brian. Sorry.
You don't need me?
No.
Okay.
No.
You're relieved.
No. I don't need you. Tom Rowland. Hey, Tom.
Yeah.
Tom, are you a licensed architect?
I am not.
Are you a certified land planner?
I am not.
Did you do this submission?
I was head of the team in charge of the submission for Partners by Design, correct.
Okay. The village has a technical rule that they say submissions are supposed to be signed by licensed design professionals. Yours wasn't signed. Why not?
Sir, how does this affect your property rights?
Well, if I have someone that wasn't a professional that submitted a report that wasn't signed, that didn't follow the rules, I'm wondering how that was submitted. I haven't heard testimony from the professional that did it, and I'm following your rules, not mine.
I would address that to staff if I were you.
I don't think the staff could waive that. I mean, it's a rule that's written. Can you waive that rule, Tony?
I believe you're referring to a building permit submittal, not a plan commission submittal. We have basic elevations, floor plans, and those are submitted by land planners. But I believe you're referring to a specific building permit submittal requirement that a licensed architect submit those plans, stamp, and sign.
It said that, accepting technical submissions have to be signed by a design professional.
For permits.
And I would state for the record that we have design professionals who are submitting plats. We heard from John Brown this evening. We heard from Jeff Rail at the last one. So we have all of the plats, the technical documentation, has been appropriately prepared by licensed officials.
Tom, are you a urban planning specialist?
I am not.
Are you an expert in the field of land planning?
I have experience in planning.
Okay.
Mr. McClure, you
what areas
about 60
of architecture does your firm specialize in?
We specialize in corporate interiors. We have done land use developments. We have done build-to-suits, multiple projects, most recently Navistar across the street.
Have you ever done any automotive mechanical schools?
I have not.
Mr. McClure, last question,
technical
please.
Technical school.
Okay. I think this is, thanks, Tom. I think this is the same thing that we found out about our air.
Thank you.
Objection.
Thank you. He's done. Thank you very much. Tony, we don't have anything else, do we? I mean, on this one? Chance to go ahead. Do you want to wrap up?
Yeah. At the inception of this case, I stood before you and stated the matter was about land use entitlements for the property. Specifically, and so what I kind of want to draw us back in on the focus of what the requests are actually before you. It's been a while since we actually talked about that. So specifically this evening, my client seeks four items of relief. One, a special use for a vocational trade or technical school. Two, a special use for an electronic sign on 88. A subdivision plat to consolidate existing lots of record, and for a special use for a plan unit development with associated departures. Those departures include request to permit a rear yard parking setback of 11 feet, to permit parking in the front yard, to permit a reduced setback, and so on. We heard all of those detailed, but there are a number of variance requests or departure requests associated with the planned unit development. In support of those requests, we've submitted a binder full of documentation, I think it runs about 300 pages, to substantiate our request. On top of that, we've submitted architectural renderings, we've submitted engineering plans, we've submitted landscape plans, we've submitted lighting plans, all prepared by licensed officials. Starting last month, we began what I think amounts to about 4.5 to 5 hours worth of public hearing on the matter. During that time, we presented 8 expert witnesses to substantiate our case. In the course of the testimony of those witnesses, they spoke to the findings of facts associated with the entitlement request before you this evening. That testimony, the written reports, through that, we believe that we've substantiated and provided you the factual basis and argument for making affirmative findings with respect to those specific requests before you. This evening, you also heard public testimony. I understand, I think Chairman Rigo stated, there have been 10 letters submitted in support of our request. We heard from 4 speakers this evening, all speaking in support of the request. I think that is certainly important to understand how the community views a request like this. In opposition, we heard from one speaker. I think it's fair to assume that the two people cross-examining might not like the project. Interestingly, one group we haven't heard from is those that live or work within the prescribed notice area. Your code requires that we provide notice to people that live within 250 feet of the property. Generally speaking, that area covers commercial areas surrounding the property and some portion of the Beaubien subdivision south of 88. I bear this out, and I think it's an interesting point, that we haven't heard from any of these residents or businesses because they are, according to the law, those that are most uniquely impacted by a development proposal within that confined area close to them. So the question becomes, what can we infer from the silence? Well, I won't speak for the residents or business owners. Certainly, I can speak to my my general experience in working on projects similar to this. And I think it's fair to say that in my experience, that people who object to a project certainly make that objection known. And we've heard that tonight. Those that support a project or those that are simply not interested in a project or simply indifferent, they just don't spend their time at these kind of hearings. Especially not on a night like tonight. I can say that I have personally had the opportunity to sit down with some of the people who would be most impacted, most notably those in the Corporate West Management Association. As we spoke to earlier, the Corporate West Management Association encompasses many of the commercial properties on the south side of Warrenville Road between I-88. They are our neighbors. They are the most uniquely impacted by this. We sat down, we made a presentation of our plans to them. I personally made a presentation of our plans to them at their annual meeting. It was a productive discussion. We've subsequently submitted a formal request to them for them to approve construction plans. I know you heard from Mr. Brink this evening. He's the president of the association. I think his position on the project is well known. Spoke to another member on the association board. I believe they are also in support of the project, and we do in fact expect to get formal approval of the construction plans from the Corporate West Management Association sometime next week. Again, I think that is certainly a relevant point and important for the consideration. I know there was one letter submitted in objection to that coming from Ms. Schnell. I'm sorry. In that letter, she states that I believe those that will be directly impacted should be considered the most. I don't think we heard from anybody today that's directly impacted. We heard from a couple of residents who lived a long ways away. I don't think that they were able to substantiate any reason that they would be uniquely impacted by this development. They wanted to argue about emissions, but our emissions experts, and they wanted to argue about noise, but our noise and emissions experts were able to substantiate that there would be no impact on them. So I believe that those that will be impacted the most are those that have been silent. They've been here, they've lobbied, they've leveled no objection to the plan, and I think that should weigh favorably in your consideration. In objection to the proposal, Ms. Idell stated that there is no need. I feel a little bit compelled to speak to that, since she did directly address one of the components of your findings on the special use for a vocational trade or technical school. She speak directly to the need at this location. So just pointing out a couple of things. We heard testimony from an individual from Volvo of Lisle, who's a service manager. He testified that there are 80 employees that they've hired from UTI. I would state that we've met with COD. There's no objection that's been leveled to COD, and I think that is in large part because of the fact that the programs that are provided at UTI do not generally overlap with the programs that are provided at COD. COD certainly does have some auto programming, but it does not get into the specificity, nor do they have the relationships that an educational provider like UTI provides. Ms. Idell stated that there wasn't a need for affluent Naperville or Lisle residents to have this kind of use. I would state for the record that Naperville sends students to the technical center of DuPage for technical training. In fact, Naperville does have a technical training program relating to engines. One of the things that we're talking about as part of this development is providing scholarship opportunities to students in the Naperville School District and the Lisle School District. To